Hi, welcome back to the Windows 8.1 UX Design Jumpstart. My name is Martin Tirion. I'm a user experience evangelist with Microsoft in the Netherlands.
Hi, I'm Chris Mayo. I'm a UX evangelist for Microsoft as well.
And in this last session, we'll look at some great examples from apps built by Microsoft, by ourselves, and what are learnings from those apps. And that can be a real great help to you when you build your apps. Now, we talked about all the things like the great ad statement and the scenario supporting your app and all the things you can do to have a very good navigation, etc. So you want to give the user the experience that it's familiar in the environment and it really is tailored to his needs. And he can really do what he expects to do with that app. So your app can be part of that experience for the user. And we talk about two apps coming from Microsoft where lessons can be learned from those apps, what they did, and maybe had eye for detail of how they handled layout and things like that. So we'll walk through those apps. And the first app we'll have a look at, and we've seen it more times these past days, is the Alarms app. And, well, I can demo the Alarms app again. I'll just do it briefly because we've seen it over and over again. Here's the Alarms app. You have the possibility to set an alarm at a specific time. So you get an alarm and you can just snooze or dismiss. So you know that you have to do something. It's very easy interface. You can switch it on and off. And you can set the time. And it's very easy to handle that and use it in the interface. The next part is timer, so you can have. I have a very hard-boiled egg here for 49 minutes and 37 seconds.
You're sure that might be a rock at this point, right? That's not an egg any longer.
Well, it's very hard. Yeah. So you have your different timers here, and you can use that and set it up to your needs, how you need it. And there's also a stopwatch where you can also have things like lab times. And browse through it and just do your timing for whatever you're timing. So that, in short, is the Alarms app. When we're looking at the principle of less is more, this is what the team also did. They also looked at what is the great ad statement for this Alarms app. And it looks a bit, or it sounds a bit funny, right? Mm-hmm. You're building an Alarms app, so why do you need a great ad statement? Well, still, again, to have focus for that app and what you will and will not implement in that app. And in this case, they came up with the greatest app in the store for working with time. And that's very, like, it's a very small, short sentence, but it has a lot of focus for the team. And what they did next is had brainstorming. So together with the team, they did some brainstorming. And you see here, there's a whiteboard and all kinds of post-it notes where they had the various IDs for the app, the scenarios, features, and stuff like that. They did voting on the scenarios and features. So they know, like, well, this should be the most important scenarios for this app or the features and et cetera. So again, this is a team effort, which really helps to brainstorm and get great IDs for the app to make the app great. So in this case, what will the app be great at? We've seen that, well, of course, it's about time, but they thought of core scenarios. So, for instance, an app that wakes me up no matter what. That seems very, like, simple, but you also have to take into account what the system can do.
Right.
So maybe the system, your PC is going to sleep. How will it wake up and your app being run to notify people? But also confidence scenarios. For instance, I know that the timers are accurate. Of course, when you want to have a very hard-boiled egg, you want to make sure that it's really hard.
Right.
And
it's less than 49 minutes.
Exactly. But you want to make sure that the timing that you set is accurate. Otherwise, something will fail or you will be too late or too early. And they also want to have some deliders as the core scenario. So, for instance, it should only take a second to set an alarm. Of course, they could have come up with all kind of hard ways to set the timer, or maybe have some drop downs and stuff like that. But they want to make it fun, but also very practical and fast to set the timers. So when we look at the core scenarios, precisely timed alarms, notification must be displayed even if the system is on standby. Also, if the alarm goes off, you should hear the alarm, although the device might be muted. So, because an alarm is something different, right? And also, the alarms can be snoozed from the notification. Now, talking about confidence and delight, they want to have customizable alarms. Of course, well, the alarm should be like customizable the time, but also maybe on which day or what the sound is for a specific alarm. So you know when you hear the alarm, well, what's happening or how you should respond to that. And of course, it should also be very performant, very fast to use. But also the deliders, a great touch-first experience, great side-by-side support. So even have it in a small window besides the work you're actually doing, maybe to time an exercise or something like that, or the work you're doing or a presentation. Those are things that you can they had as a goal for this app. Now, when we talk about navigation, we talked about, for instance, navigation bar, right? That's a standard thing that you can use, a control that you can use. But for this app, they came up with just the on-screen navigation. So you see the alarm, and you can go to the timer tab, and you can go to the stopwatch. Right. It's very easy to navigate, and there will never be more than three pieces you want to navigate between. And they're very small, and you have room for the navigation. So decided to have that all on screen and have that as a navigation model. So again, they really thought this through if this was the best solution or they should have a navigation bar. So again, thinking about navigation in your screen, your application.
And I think that the team did a really, really great job if you look at that navigation scheme. You know, and this is when we talked yesterday about patterns and maybe, you know, two different patterns or mixing patterns, you know, between flat and hierarchical and stuff. But the team really thought about scenarios. I mean, this is a utility app where there's really only three different scenarios. And they could have set that up as being, you know, like a flat scheme where like I'd have to go to a navigation bar to switch between like the different groups of timers and alarms and stuff like that. Or, you know, have them be like in like a hub with different sections of here's all my alarms or the first six alarms and then here's the timers I have and stuff like that. But when you look at the UI, it's just super straightforward and super simple. I go into that app for the first time and I can see what it does.
Yeah.
It's alarms. It's stopwatches and it's timers.
Yeah.
And it's easy to switch between them and use them. And it's funny because, you know, if you tried to apply that same thing to like a news app where maybe I had 20 different categories, I mean, they'd be littered everywhere and it would be taking up a lot of screen real estate.
Exactly.
And it just wouldn't work. So I think it's a great example of just a team going through and saying, hey, what are we about? What are these scenarios? How can I make it as fast and fluid as humanly possible to navigate amongst those different scenarios and just get that timer started or just get that alarm set and go back to what I'm doing?
Yeah, and the beauty of when we look at the app again, for instance, when we have the alarms app and the middle one, almost lunch, when I open it up, you see that everything is in green.
Yeah.
So it gives me, with the navigation, a lot of context of which alarm I'm using in this case. Or when I just save to go back and go to the other one, you see everything is pink in this one.
Right.
So also color is being used here in the navigation and to give you an idea where you are and what kind of information you're looking at now. Okay, so that's the navigation. Now the UI controls. They wanted to use controls built in the platform as much as possible because it gives you a very quick jump start on building the app, but they also want to focus on where they could differentiate or help the user maybe in a better way or in a different way to customize it. So they went in customizing controls to adapt it to their IDs and how they can make it personal to the user and really stand out with that alarms app. So that's what they did. They modified some of those controls. fronts we already talked about, once and repeats, where they just use a toggle, right, and just use a color to switch between those two. Those were just standard things they used, but just tweaked a little bit, right, to get a better use of that. Now, customizing controls, they wanted to use with the standard controls because so much work is being done in the standard controls, like animation, but also things like accessibility of globalization. It's all built in the standard controls, so they want to make use of that. And there's a little video here we want to watch that shows what the team was thinking about this.
All right, so the designers had a great idea for what they wanted the app to look and feel like, but unfortunately, it wasn't quite along the same lines of what XAML provides us by default. If you look at a regular text box, it has a border, it has a background. With a checkbox or a toggle button, you have a solid outline and the contents within there. The designers wanted something that was slightly different. They wanted a larger typography. They wanted a transparent background for text boxes, and just in general, larger buttons. And the great part about XAML is with all the basic controls, you can just override their styles and templates and get the design exactly how you want it to be.
So that's a very nice introduction in how they were thinking about using those controls, especially with the text control, make all those borders disappear, make really part of the experience.
I think that's a great example when you look at that UI. I mean, the saturated colors, the animation, you know, the way they're using like the Sago UI font, it's obvious that it's a Microsoft app, like it's a first-party app. But even in that app, they turned up the personality a bit. Like you had said, with that text box not being, you know, the square around it with the X, they made it just something that felt really, really in line and seamless to, yep, the UI. Changing that radio button for once and repeats to being based on color and not on the radio button itself. I mean, those are things that, you know, differentiated and turned up the personality on that app, even beyond just the Windows personality that you're going to see in the templates.
Yeah.
Right? So still looks like Microsoft, still has that saturated color and personality and so on, but feels unique and feels differentiated.
Still have its own identity.
Yeah,
for
exactly.
The app.
Yeah, even for an app that you could maybe say is super simple and it's a utility app, that doesn't mean it can't have personality and can't have a visual interest and can't have uniqueness and delight.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an alarm app, and I mean, I know the first time I saw it, I just kept turning on and turning off alarms to see that sweeping animation. You know?
Yeah, exactly, yeah, exactly. You did the same.
I did the same.
Me
just
too.
Over and over.
It took me hours.
Hours.
Okay, when we look at creating light with custom controls, so their design goal was to have a control to set and read the time. These are some early sketches that they used for the ideas on how to manipulate the time and how to work with those circles. And that dial control is now a visual that they use throughout the app. It's clear to everyone, right? You see the dials, you see how you can handle it, you can change the time, and it's very visual. So they put a lot of work in building this app. This is an early early prototype of the dial app, where you see there are the alarm timer and stopwatch, so that changed a bit. But you see that the colors and the circles were already there. But it was all about making it beautiful, but also making it readable. So it doesn't make sense if it's only beautiful and no one understands what it,
right,
is. Or you,
right,
have to very have a very good eye for detail to see what the time is, for instance. So they took it very seriously. And even this simple control, now,
right,
you see it, they put a lot of effort in just fine-tuning and make sure that this was a good control and good usable for the user. Now, designing the dial control, they thought of the Windows 8.1 personality. They want to be part of that, but also the direct manipulation and the delighter moments of the control, like you said, like switching it on and off just because the animation is so beautiful.
Right.
Let's watch another video where the team explains about this control.
As part of the challenge with this simple apps is
One is the physical aspect of it, like how do you fit the simple apps into a Windows 8 model? Like how do you make the content shine, because it's an alarm app, it's not, you know, it's not a media app, it's not a news app. And the second one is how do you bring surprise and delight, because that's one of the goals for the apps in this release. New things we introduced here is the dial control. It's supposed to be simple to use, but it's got like inherent complexity in actually, you know, building it, because well, one thing is we never really did anything like this before, so this is a new type of control, and the prototyping really helps there. It helps us to uncover the potential challenges, both technically and from interaction standpoint.
So when you look at what they explained in the team, in all the work that went in this one control, in this just this very simple app, you see that eye for detail really matters, right. And pride in craftsmanship. And then you really get an experience that delights the user and is very, well, good to use. When we look at the next slides, you also see that the different sections, like alarm timer and stopwatch, when I snap it to the side, so make it a smaller window, and they also thought of a very good design, so it's still good readable, yeah, and usable, and still the controls are there, and it's, yeah, very handy to use.
I think it's something that, I mean, whenever, and I know you and I talk about this all the time, and you know, you read articles about, you know, designers, regardless if we're designing, you know, industrial design or web design or for these apps, and they talk a lot about iteration. You know, you can, yep, do your research, you can try, you know, different prototypes and A/B testing, and that iteration, that tuning, you know, what you learn as you're trying things and stuff like that. I mean, I think that video and the end result kind of speak towards, you know, trying to go for delight and trying something different, testing it, iterating on it, and to the point where you get that experience that's truly delightful. And yep, whether you're turning those alarms on and off or setting the time of a timer just through direct manipulation, the control just feels right.
Yeah.
It feels super high quality.
Yeah, but it needs a lot of eye for detail, yeah, and also thinking about performance, and it works everywhere in the same way, and it still has this good feel of the animation and stuff like that. So that's the work you can do to really bring those delighters in an app and still make it very functional. So layout. Again, there was a very good thought of how the layout was of this page and how you can use the on-screen commands very good to still switch on and off the alarms, for instance, or go to another alarm, as we've seen in the demo. A very nice layout there. Also for things like the different timers, to remove a timer just by clicking, have an on-screen delete button, because that's all of the part of the core scenarios, right? There's nothing much to do with the timer.
And if you look at that last screenshot, I think it's, again, one of these things we talked about in layout. We talked about on-page core scenarios versus, yep, you know, transient UI. I mean, that's something that right there, you know, that plus sign in the upper right-hand corner, I know, just I look at the screen, and I remember the first time I looked at the app, the first time I saw it in an early build, it's like, it was totally apparent on how I would add a new timer.
Yeah.
I saw the plus button. I tapped on it. I got that practice test. You know, I went ahead and set all the parameters and the parameters of what the practice test was going to be like and stuff like that. But even, you know, being able to turn on and turn off, reset and be able to delete just all from that, you know, all from that just front page,
yeah,
without having to go into an edit mode or navigate anywhere.
Yeah.
Just a great example. I mean, the team really thought about making this something lightweight and direct and,
exactly,
very discoverable and very, very fluid.
Yeah.
I think it's a great example. Again, it's a simple utility app, but you can tell that they really sweat the details and came up with a great result.
Yeah, exactly. And you still see the grid. So
yeah,
there's alignment, yeah, here. You see the rows and columns without being too static.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Windowing. They also thought of windowing the different window sizes and make sure that it also scales to all the DPIs. And again, when I start trimming it down, it's still the horizontal browsing experience, but when I make it even smaller, you get the vertical experience. Yeah. So you see all your timers or your alarms there, and you can still manipulate it and use it. So again, a very well thought idea of how to do the windowing and where to trim down to minimize layout, etc.
Yeah, and they did it again from a responsive standpoint. They just did a fantastic job. Like, I could be taking a practice test, you know, or I'm going to study for an hour before I take a break or something like that.
Yeah.
Have it side by side with all my other apps, and it's and it just it it still works and looks great, which
exactly.
is the goal that you want.
Yeah. So that's the alarms app. The next app we want to talk about is the calculator app. And this is also, I think, a nice one. There's a lot to learn from this one. The nice thing is that, well, actually, it's a really simple app, right?
Yeah.
Let's just have a look at the calculator app. Of course, there's the Windows calculator app that we know that was in Windows 7 and before. But they wanted to make something that was also an immersive app, where they had the same like core functionality
right.
that you could do, but in a different way presenting it or giving the interaction model. So here's the standard calculator. So I could do something like, I always use the calculator for this to
difficult.
Because that's very difficult.
It's
so you have your you have your normal stuff here, but there's also a scientific calculator. So now it gets more complex. and even in this way, it's very handy to use, and it's very clear. You see what's happening there, and all the things all the functions you have there. Another thing that they added was a converter. So in this case, if I have a volume in milliliters, and I'll just add 7, 6 something, and how many US teaspoons
right.
that is. Those are strange measurements, but, well, for me as a European, right?
Right.
And the nice thing is that at the bottom, you see also that it's also shown in other quantities that are often used, but they also have something like, 765 milliliters is through 3.23 coffee cups.
Right, right.
And, well, it's just a divider. It doesn't make sense, you would say. On the other hand, it gives you an idea how
right.
much it is, right?
Yeah, I mean, something that, you know, you might not know how much 765, you know, milliliters is, but you could envision, you know, a few coffee cups, right? 3.2 coffee cups.
Or in this case, 765 liters is 2.02 bathtubs.
Exactly.
So you have an idea of the scale of it.
Yeah, exactly.
And for instance, when we go to the length and do it in centimeters, so 765 centimeters is actually 0.1 jumbo jets.
Right.
Or when I trim it down a bit and go to 76 centimeters, it says it's 4.7 hands.
Right.
Or when I have 7 centimeters, it's 2 paper clips. So it just gives you an ID. And it's not really that important. But again, it's a divider and it has a function.
Yeah.
So I thought that was a very nice thing of the calculator app. Now let's see how they came to this ID. Of course, less is more important. Again, focus on what is this app great at. It's not just building a calculator, but think of the great at statement. Now, they came up with core scenarios. They wanted to make it, gave it the same functionality as the desktop app that was already there. And there is a lot of functionality behind that calculator app. You would say, well, you would just add and subtract and stuff like that. But after combination of all those mathematic components, it's quite complex logic.
Yeah.
So they just wanted to reuse that, but have another UI in front of it.
And it's something that like you don't, until you talk to the team and you think about like how often and how many times a day that app is used. I mean, it's the calculator in Windows. Windows is used by billions of people, and you know the statistics on how much that app is being used. So it, you know, providing that same engine and providing it in a fresh and modern way that supported all the windowing support and being localized to all the different regions and countries that Windows runs in and stuff. I mean, it might seem like a fairly simple task or a fairly simple app, but they did a great job, and it was a lot of responsibility to provide. I mean, essentially a replacement for the calculator that people have been using you know, since the beginning of Windows, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So again, it should be useful, and they wanted to make it beautiful, but the main scenario is just using it, maybe with a test or with just calculating something for your work. So it should be very fast and fluid and good to use. So they wanted to give it a new, fresh, modern experience, but also think about localization and globalization, which is very important to use even with a calculator. And also they want to make sure that it was great at all sizes. So if you just snap it in a very small window, then it would still be very good in use and a very good companion for your work. Now, thinking about confidence and delight, of course, confidence in the accuracy. You don't want to have the wrong numbers when you do a calculation, right? But also have the scientific calculator there and the everyday conversions. Now, that's new in this app compared to the desktop calculator, to just do the conversions of specific measurements of length and volumes and things like we showed in the demo. But also have fun unit conversions, as we saw, like the bathtubs or the jumbo jets and things like that. So it's a delighter, but again, it also gives you information. Now, thinking about the layout, and this I thought was, I really was amazed by what the team did, because this was the least of the problems. In my opinion,
right.
But then when they talked about this, it's not just about putting just letters and numbers on buttons and center it and you're done. They needed really several rounds of tweaking to really make it work and to look fine. So this is really pride in craftsmanship and have eye for detail. Now, what did they do? This is the first, let's say, the first round that they did. So just have a simple, all those numbers and all those specific buttons, fill them up with the text and center it, and there it was. And immediately they said, well, this doesn't feel right. Some things are differently aligned because there's superscript.
Superscript and subscript.
Anywhere
from text to different mathematical symbols and all these different things. And if you look at the red lines, I mean, nothing was centered just by taking the default and just centering a bunch of text.
Exactly. Right? So it looks a bit messy. And and also the result here at 246.24, it's really like in your face.
Right.
There was a lot going on here, and they were not really happy with it. So they went through iterations, and they were looking at the typography used and did some tuning here. And they ended up with this 6 different font weights and sizes. Where they have for every button, they determined which of the 6 was good for that button. So
right. It
really aligns, and it felt right, and it had the right size, etc. So they did a lot of work in this. But also a lot of the margins adjustment. It wasn't about just centering the content, but for every button they would determine, well, what's the best top margin, a left margin, to make it really feel good in that button. There was a lot of work going on here.
You can see that, I mean, in some cases, they tuned to the pixel.
Yeah.
And the result, I mean, looks fantastic, right? I mean,
yeah.
If you just took the default, it kind of looked kind of jumbled and misaligned. And yeah,
yeah, now you
worked.
See sometimes 26 pixels or 28 pixels,
yeah, exactly.
Or 27. And then you say, so why is this 27, the other is 28? It's just that eye for detail that really makes it look right. And to just compare what happened, so this was before, this was the first iteration. And then after they did all the tuning, it became this. So again, this was before, and this was after.
Yeah.
And you see that this is a more clean UI. The result is good readable, but it's less in your face. It's not that bold font anymore.
Yeah.
And the rest is it's very good tuned to the button, so it really feels good. And it has a good layout.
And that was the thing that I thought was really funny. When you looked at that first version, even if you took the red lines off it, you know, it looked okay. But it did look like, I mean, some of the text on the buttons was bigger than others, and it almost gave you that weird feeling like, why is this Like, why is to the power of 10 more important than like sine or cosine or pi or something like that?
Yep.
It was really, really strange until you see the end result when everything is aligned well and everything is the same, you know, relative size and weight of font. It just suddenly, yeah, everything feels nice and even and balanced.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And maybe most of the people don't see that don't have that first experience that when they see this they say like, whoa, it's okay, it just works.
Yeah.
But when with this eye for detail and all this work that went in just this UI, it gives a far much better experience to the user. Now globalization and localization, that's also a very big thing. They did a lot of work in that. Of course, you get a lot of free from the platform, but they also needed to do things like what is the decimal symbol, or what is the what are the native digits, or how do you group, or what kind of symbols do you use for the grouping? So they had to get information about all those regional formatting for numbers and use that in the UI as well. So it really reflects what the user is well known to and what his settings are. And as you see in this screen, I have no idea what's going on here. but it's obviously a right to left language. Mm-hmm. And for the user in this language, it will feel very, very natural to his environment, what he's known to.
And that's the great thing about the globalization and localized engine from Windows is that getting, you don't have to think about what's the decimal symbol, the decimal symbol or the digit grouping and whatnot. The APIs give that to you just for the machine as it's installed. They have that language installed. So it makes a big difference. Even substituting some of the characters, right, and putting the right character set in.
Yep.
It's a great boon for us as publishers that want to be truly worldwide.
Yeah. So the information is there, but you have to implement it in your app to make it really work and make it really shine in your app. Now, this is another example. I think this was the Bengalese script. So even in that, it looks fine in Bengalese. And I think it looks fine in Bengalese, but I'm sure it does.
Right.
But it still has that nice feel of what the weight of the buttons is and the characters and how it works and how you can use this. So again, all that eye for detail also in other languages and using that in globalization. Now when you think of windowing, of course, a calculator is something that's mostly used beside other work. So you want to have it maybe on the side. You can use it in a single view, of course, as we did in the demo. But also think of an adaptive strategy.
Right.
Like you mentioned yesterday, think of what will happen when I trim down the window and what will happen, where will the controls be and how will it still be very accessible and usable.
I think we actually had a video for that, right?
There. Oh, that's a video, yeah. We'll look at a short video.
One of the interesting challenges we had with 8.1 that's very different from Windows 8 was that we didn't have fixed view states of, hey, you're in landscape, you're in portrait, you're in snapped, and that's the end of that. We had a more adaptive windowing model here, which was all about different resolutions, different screen sizes, new form factors, things of that nature. And so we had to create UI that adapted in that nature. One of the directions people tend to go usually with stuff like that is, you know, you create different views for the different plateaus you might have and create your UI according to that. And the approach we took was very different because we used one view and we morphed it and translated it in ways that made sense at different plateaus, at different resolutions, at different orientations. And that was actually fairly straightforward to do with XAML.
So again, it's nice to see the work that the team put in using this in these scenarios and really have it as a helpful app beside other apps so I can really use that in those scenarios and think about the strategy, what happens when you trim down the window.
And they did a great job of coming up with that one view and following the strategy we talked about in the windowing session so that you could have one view that is truly responsive rather than having tons and tons of views that you have to develop and test and so on.
Yeah.
They did a great job.
So, and again, you see the same method here. So when it's a trimmed down version, there's a header control, so you can go to scientific and converter instead of just tapping that once. And still have that all the UI there. You see the scientific calculator, for instance, in the middle. Then the buttons for all the scientific functions are above the numbers. So there's a different layout here, and still very easy to use in that fashion, and still recognizable in that kind of layout. So the app gallery, there's an app gallery on design.windows.com that's very useful if you want to have more inspiration of apps. And there are various apps there that can be very useful to you to dig into. So for instance, here when I browse through, you see the Great British Chefs that we show yesterday. One of my favorites is also Cocktail Flow, okay, because of all the animation that's done there. Maybe I don't use the app, only for demos, yeah, but that's why it's full of delighters, right? And it's with all the animations where you see the ingredients pop up. It's really a well-thought animation scheme that they use there. But also, for instance, when you think of the Foursquare application, when you dig in there, there's more information here, what it is and what they did to make the app great. And there's some videos here and images. So you can get a really good idea of how they made the app as it is. And things that you can learn and maybe get ideas from for your own app, how you do a layout maybe, or maybe a navigation or a transition and stuff like that. So be sure to also use the gallery on the on design.windows.com, because it provides a lot of information for you to get inspired and know what to do there. Oh yeah, there we go again. So to sum it all up, the great Windows Store apps, and of course there are far more examples of that. Think of the Mail app, for instance, with all the details they had there. But what you saw now from these very small apps like Calculator and like the Alarms app, you see that the team focuses on what makes that app great. What is the focus of that app? And what are the core scenarios? And then they also thought of, well, how can it best be used? Like the controls, and we've seen the animations, and we've seen also the delighters. A lot of work that went into the details. Also the iteration on the design. It was not just like, well, there was a designer and he just draws something and there it is and now just make it. There was a lot of effort put into the designs, and not only visual, but also is it really practical to use in the interaction model. So you need iterations for that to come to the right model for the user. But then also think about all the UX guidelines as we discussed in the past 2 days. They also use those guidelines to think about using the grid typography, for instance, how big the fonts are, or how the navigation is, or what the layout is, or how you do the windowing and things like that. All those guidelines help them to really think about the scenarios and integrate into the Windows system and really be part of the complete UI. And of course, they leverage the platform because they use like standard buttons and control and text boxes and et cetera, but just did some tweaking also there to really make it part of their app and part of their experience. And we saw the Windows App Gallery up on the Design Center. Make sure that you use that as well and see a lot of an inspiration there to help you think about your apps as well. So the resources, well, we've seen that over and over again. Design.windows.com, really a good resource to use. You can find all the guidelines there. It's in separate sections with all kind of examples. You can also have the download the PDF there with all the guidelines in one PDF if you want to have it offline. So all that information is there. And the Windows Store App Design Gallery that's up there. And you can access it also through design.windows.com. So that's it about great apps and some examples from the team. So first, I want to thank you for joining us these past 2 days with all the sessions. We hope it was really helpful for you. we ask you to think about the poll that you can find on the page just below the video. Make sure that you let us know what you thought of all the presentations and this material, so we can maybe improve it and help you to build great apps. I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
No, just thanks a lot. Thanks for spending the past couple days with us, and thanks, Martin, for flying out here to Redmond to do the jumpstart with me. So,
well, thank you for inviting me, and see you next time. So, thank you.
Thanks.